Okay, good. We are good to know. We are good to go. Welcome, everybody. So today we just continue with the emission processes. The last time we have seen several things that are related to electrodynamics, in which we have seen how through the Larmor formula we can compute several phenomena that characterizes charged particles, like for example electrons or protons. And we have seen, we studied the various scenarios. We have seen the case for Beck reaction, in which we kind of completed electrodynamics with a patch by introducing this effective force that takes care of the fact that whenever you have a charged particle which is emitting radiation, it's losing energy, and therefore it's losing its kinetic energy that is going to be transformed into this radiation. Then we have seen the case of the scenario in which we have an electron, which is beamed to a proton, for instance, or to a charged ion. And we studied the cross-section for such a scenario, which is nothing but the capacity of our electron in this specific configuration to capture an incoming flux of an electromagnetic wave. Then we have seen another scenario in which we have a free electron. And again, we computed the cross-section that we see that in this case is constant. And it's the total cross-section. In the end, we derive the total cross-section, which is called the Thompson cross-section. Again, it's the capacity of the electron to capture an incoming electromagnetic wave. And by seeing at these two different configurations, you can basically see how the cross-section is not an intrinsic property of the electron, but it's actually related to its interaction with electromagnetic wave, given the scenario in which the electron is living in, like if it's in a bound state or in a free state. So you see that this is an interplay between the cross-sections, and given by it expresses an interplay between the incoming electromagnetic wave and the electron itself. And in fact, we have seen how there is a frequency dependency on the cross-section, as well as there is an angular dependency on the cross-section. So depends on the direction of the incoming electromagnetic wave and the direction of motion of the electron, the cross-section has an angular dependency. It's not the same all over the angles. So that's about the past lecture. And now we continue and study the synchrotron radiation. In this case, and this is very relevant for astrophysics because it concerns a lot of astrophysical objects, because we have synchrotron radiation, for example, within our galaxy. We have a ionized medium within our galaxy. There are magnetic fields in our galaxies, and we have this sort of emission. We have, for example, from AGNs, active galactic nuclei. In this case, we have a black hole over which we have matter accreting. So imagine that there is a matter that is accreted onto the black hole. It's falling into the black hole. This matter starts to spin around the black hole, creating, getting extremely high, ionizing itself, creating magnetic field. Magnetic field then creates jets and accelerate the particles along two jets that are orthogonal to the plane along which the material is accreting over the black hole. Therefore, you have the creation of magnetic field, and you have free electrons that are accelerated, moving this magnetic field, and they create synchrotron radiation. And you can basically see this jet through this emission. So how does it work? Well, I already mentioned by giving you these a couple of examples in which we have free electrons, and then we have the presence of a magnetic field. Okay, we are basically assuming that there is no relevant electric field in the scenario. So that's the case in which we have the synchrotron radiation. So as usual, what we do, we go through we just study the equation of motion to see how the electron is accelerated, and we use the and to get to know that we basically use the Lorentz force. And as you can see, there is not the electric components because there is no electric field. Moreover, gamma is constant because gamma contains the velocity of the particles, and the acceleration, as you can see from this equation, is centripetal. Therefore, you have the electric field that perhaps is pointing vertically, and the electron is spinning around the lines of the magnetic field in this way. Okay, and the acceleration is always centrifugal. It means the absolute value of the velocity, okay, the velocity when it's here is pointing your direction and then it spins around, but the velocity of the particle is constant because, as we have seen, the magnetic component of the Lorentz force is not producing any work. There is not any acceleration with respect to the absolute value. It's not going to change, of the velocity is not going to change as a function of time. Then what we do is just to, let's make a little bit of geometry and let's go to see what is the actual configuration of the magnetic field with respect to the plane of the orbit of our particle. And for simplicity, I can basically align the line of the magnetic field along the Z direction of our axis. So we are going to have like the magnetic field that is pointing this direction, the Z direction with blue pointing. So we have our B. This is the Z direction. So that's EZ vector. And the orbit is something like that. Okay. The electron, let's take it in this position, is orbiting, for example, with a velocity that goes along the beta vector. So that's the velocity. Remember that beta is equal to V over C. That's our electron. The observer is perhaps located in this position and is watching in this direction. And this vector, E, identifies the direction, the line of sight of the observer. It has an angle theta with respect to the velocity of the electron that is spinning around the orbit. Now we can, you see these are three equations. Because it's you see that there are vectors here, so there are three-dimensional vectors, so we have three equations. And the Lorentz force, if we just look at the three components of the velocity separately, just give us the gamma factor that is constant, so this kind of goes outside. We get take the Vz component dot, because we have the time derivative of the velocity, equal to the constant. And the velocity along this direction, along the Z direction, is equal to zero. And therefore, this gives us a zero. Then we have the other components, V gamma y. And we have the constants, minus E over mc, x component, and magnetic field, absolute value of the magnetic field, which is B. Then we have the other component, similarly, x dot is equal to, again, the constants, mc, and then in this case, where we are dyb, okay? And what we can do is we want to find out our final equation of motion, and something that is very convenient to take the time derivative of these equations, such that we obtain v dot z, which is equal to zero, because zero goes to zero.
Wir machen gerade das, was meine Erstis auf dem letzten Zettel rechnen durften. Was ich jeden Montag geklärt habe.
Hi guys, sorry, one of you has the mic on and we are hearing a private discussion. Can you please turn it off? Okay, thank you. So let's continue. V dot dot, again, time derivative of this equation. So we have again, we have a V dot dot of y component is equal to minus E B over gamma M C V dot X. Okay, that's, you see this, there are all constants except for this, and I brought the gamma on the other side. You see that it moved here. Similarly, for the x direction, minus eb over gamma mc, but we have the y component. Okay, then we can use a sort of a trick, because you see that we have this, this dot x that we can plug into here, and this v y that dot that we can plug into here, so that we get an equation that it's only related to double time derivatives with respect to double time derivatives. So let's do the substitution. And of course, we have always this v dot dot z equal to zero that is unchanged, with dot dot y equal, after I made the substitution with the v dot x, we have e b over gamma mc squared vy, and v dot dot x is equal to e b over gamma mc squared v x. So you see, with by making this substitution, I have vy, vy, vx, vx. In this way, I can solve my equation. And I can define, you see that there is this constant that is common for the two, and it's actually a frequency that is called the Larmor frequency. Gamma mc, which for typical scenarios, you see it's of the order of a few hertz over gamma. That's B over in microgauss. And then per unit of the mass of the electron. That's called Larmor frequency. Okay, that it characterizes the frequency, the orbital frequency. So it's, that's related to the orbital velocity of our particle. Then if we want to have the emission, we use the Larmor formula. The Larmor formula, in the case of relativistic electrons, because in this case we are using relativistic electrons, and if we look at this configuration, the velocity is in this direction. V dot, as I said, is centripetal. So the velocity and the acceleration are orthogonal one with respect to each other, because we are dealing with a circular orbit. Okay, so the power for the synchrotron radiation is going to be the P over the omega. So I'm looking at the angular dependency of the power. So I'm looking what is the energy which is emitted for a certain direction of a solid angle, for pi C one minus beta E to the power of 5. So you see there is a 5 here. So I'm already accounting for the retardation, the retardation of time. And again, remember that we are dealing with relativistic electrons, and therefore we have quite a relevant beaming. You know that this is again related to the transformation that are given by the Lorentz. It's related to the Lorentz transformation. So if we have at rest our electron that is emitting radiation in an isotropic wave, meaning that the flux into the energy per unit of time, for the power that is emitting in this direction or any direction is the same. But for us observer that sees electron moving with a relativistic velocity, the power is actually kind of distorted in this way. So the electron is emitting more power in along the direction of motion of the electron and less in the other directions. Okay, therefore we have this kind of flashlight phenomenon, if you wish, in which you have less radiation orthogonal and with the back of the electron with respect to the direction of motion of the electron. Most of the flux is pushed forward, is emitted forward. Let's see how, let's say, relevant is this beaming. And to do that, let's look first of all, what is the maximum of the emitted power. So how relevant is the beaming? So to do that, we look for the maximum power. And this happens when theta is equal to zero, which means when beta and the direction of view of the observer are aligned. Okay, so if we go back to our orbit, the electron is spinning in this way. Let's take this instant of time, the observer would be placed here. Okay, when theta is equal to zero, we are basically the direction of motion of the electron that is pointing in our direction. Here we have the maximum of our emission, and you can see it from here because beta, if the particle is almost relativistic, is close to one. It means that these terms become close to zero. That makes everything very large because there is a power of five. So you see how relevant it is. So let's then let's see the value for the maximum, which is the how we can relate to the gamma factor. And we have this term, which is 1 minus beta epsilon minus 1, so it's 1 over. And then we can make the power of 5, but for simplicity, it's easier to do computations like this, which is equal to, as we said, the two vectors are parallel one with respect to each other. So we have 1 minus beta to the minus 1. Now I can take advantage of the fact that these terms can be slightly reshuffled a little bit. So this one is equal to 1 minus beta, 1 plus beta. That's equal to, there are no approximations here. And I'm just using this part of the equation plugged into here. So we have 1 plus beta over 1 minus beta squared. But as I said, we are dealing with a relativistic particle. So beta is roughly equal to 1. It means that this term is roughly 2. And if I now use the definition of gamma, we can see that this guy is equal to 2 gamma. Okay? Squared, actually. Good. So you can see how this term is related, is giving you a 2 gamma square factor. It means that and it goes in the boosting here. So it's because this is to the minus 1, so it's above. It means that this 2 gamma factor is above here, is at the numerator. Therefore, it gives you an extremely large flux, gamma square. Then we can ask ourselves, how large is the cone along which we have the emission? Can you see my mouse, by the way?
Yes.
Okay, good. So then we can ask ourselves, what is the cone at which we have at least 50% of the total emission? Okay. At which theta we have 0.5 of the maximum emitted power. Okay, we can then take our the term that we had from before. So we have 1 minus beta e to the minus 1. That's equal now is not anymore, these are not anymore along the same direction, but we have a difference in angle that is theta. So we get a cosinus, 1 minus beta cosinus of theta. That's because it is a unit vector to the minus 1. And we are asking ourselves when this factor is larger than 1/2 of the power. Okay, which is what we got from the previous step. And this is basically the same equation, but coming from above where theta is equal to 0, we have the maximum of the power. So we are looking for this condition. So what we do, we are looking for the angle at which this happens. So we just isolated the cosinus of theta. That it's from this equation turns out to be 2 minus 1 over beta. So I'm just isolating this term from this equation here. Then I can Taylor expand the cosinus of theta. Actually, it's an approximation. So it's 1 minus theta squared over 2. I plug it into here, and what I get is that the angle theta must be smaller or equal than the square root of 2, 1 minus beta over beta, where again, this guy is approximately 1. And therefore, I can again use the trick that I used before. You see, I have this 1 minus beta. It's equal to 1 minus beta square over 1 plus beta, and I just plug it into here. So that we have, again, square root of 2, 1 minus beta square over 1 plus beta. Where I took advantage of the fact that this beta is approximately 1. This is, as before, roughly 2, because the electron is almost relativistic. We are with this that cancel with this one, with this other 2, and we are left with 1 minus beta square, which is of the square root, 1 minus beta square root, which is actually the inverse of the gamma factor. So you see that the gamma factor, since we are dealing with a relativistic electron, is very large number, which makes theta a very small number because we have this minus 1. Quindi, therefore, theta is very small. This basically is going to tell us that the total power which is emitted, that has this angular dependency here. So this is you see squared, therefore it's just it goes into the modulus of the power, into the absolute value of the power. The direction is given by this factor, and by these very simple considerations, we basically see that the total emission for our electron is basically confined with the maximum P max that we computed here. That is a 2 gamma squared, and then you have all the constants and so on. So the total, the maximum here, and where you have P max over 2, you have this angle theta that we computed here that is equal to the inverse of the gamma minus 1. So it's the inverse of gamma, which means that this angle is very small. Therefore, the electron is pointing this direction. As soon as you move by a bit from the direction of motion of the electron, you get that your flux is already half of it. And if you move even more, it's going to be basically negligible. Almost all the power is emitted forward with respect to direction of motion of the electron. Okay, so if I make the sketch again, that's our electron. The electron is moving with beta in this direction, and basically the emission, if I just draw the cone within that is defined by this angle theta, where we have half of the total, half of the maximum of the power, this angle is roughly gamma to the minus one. Okay, again, the magnetic field is orthogonal to the orbit of the plane. Therefore, beaming is super relevant. And as we are going to see, that's going to be have a strong impact on the shape of the power spectrum of the spectrum of the radiation. Now let's continue. Let's see what is the total emitted power. And we use the integrated Larmor formula over all angles. So we are just we already derived that in a general case. 2e squared over 3c gamma 6. Then we have beta dot square minus beta cross beta dot square. That's a beta. And since the orbit is orthogonal, as I said, the beta is pointing in this direction, the acceleration is pointing inward. Okay, because it's a centrifugal force. These two are orthogonal. Therefore, this guy here is actually equal to beta, beta dot squared because there is this squared here. Okay, therefore, all of this term here is going to be equal to beta dot squared one minus beta squared. Okay, because what I did was just to pull out from the the parentheses, the beta dot, how it is beta dot squared that goes here. We have the one minus what is left, which is beta squared. Okay. I can use the definition of the gamma factor. You can see from here. And that's equal to beta dot squared gamma to the minus two. That gives us our 2e squared over 3c, these are the constants, gamma to the minus 2, gamma to the power of 6, they cancel a bit, and we get a gamma to the power of 4, and then we have the beta dot squared, which is left here. Now we can relate our beta dot to the magnetic field and the Larmor cross section. We have beta dot from our previous derivation, which is related to the velocity, to the angular velocity. That's beta phi dot, right? Because if I can now define, let's say that we have an initial position, I can define this phi, that is the angle that defines the position of the electron along the orbit, and I can relate my beta dot to the angular velocity, which is equal to omega Larmor. That's from the previous result, right? Because this is the definition of an angular frequency. Okay, that we have the and for which we have the explicit expression from here, where we derived the equation of motion of our electron that give us 2e squared over 3c gamma 6 ep over gamma mc squared. If I now relate the magnetic field to the energy density of the magnetic field in this way over 8 pi, I basically have this final relation that I can link to the Thompson cross section. Okay, so you see just all the constant that I have here, once I introduced my my relation between the magnetic field and the energy density, I can basically extract all the constants to group them into the Thompson cross section that we have here. This is the total power which is emitted by an electron that is moving in a magnetic field. No electric field is involved. Okay. Then we can move on and look for the spectrum of this radiation. For which we already have the general expression, as I just remind you. So we have the E over the omega, the omega. So that's the total energy which is emitted. So the spectrum is defined as the energy which is emitted per unit of frequency, because as I said, the emission can be colored, so to say, okay? It's not a monochromatic emission, but it is an emission with which is spanning a broader range of frequencies. And this spectrum can depend on the direction over which the radiation is emitted, okay? So radiation in one direction can be dominated by a certain frequency, and along another direction can be dominated by a different frequency. Okay, so the color of the radiation depends also on the direction of propagation of the radiation, where the radiation is emitted. But is that something you already know? Okay, 4 pi squared c, then we have the modulus of the integral between minus infinite to infinite of e cross beta, e to the I omega, t prime minus e x over c, integrated over the t prime squared, where t prime refers to the variable in the integral. Okay, it has nothing to do with rest frames or anything. And the retardation, you see that I'm using retarded, introduced already in the Fourier transform that arrived at this equation for the spectrum. You see that I already introduced the retarded time. You can see the imprint of the retarded time up here. Okay. Good. Now what we need to do to have the explicit expression, we need to compute this guy here and this guy here. Okay, for the specific configuration of that we are dealing with. So let's give first a look at this term here. So we look at E bar cross E cross B. We can just now use just the relationship that relates the cross product with scalar products that give us this equation. These guys are unit vectors, therefore this is equal to 1. That's not approximation, is equal to 1. And now if we look at the geometry of our scenario, let me make a better drawing so that all angles are clear, because here the important is to understand how the angles look like and how everything is oriented. So let's make it a little bit larger. That's the central of the orbit. That's the direction EY, then we have EX, which is in this direction, which is as well the direction of motion, that is also the identifies the direction along which the electron is moving. The Z direction is going to be this one. And we know that the magnetic field is oriented in this way. Okay, that's the center of the orbit. Our angle phi that identifies the position of the electron is this one. Then we have, let me change color. Then we have the observer that now I locate up here. So that identifies the vector E, so the direction where the point in the line of sight of the observer, that's the angle theta that we have seen before as well. Okay, And then let me just complete the drawing. I can define another vector, which is orthogonal to the line of sight of the observer and the y direction. And I call it E orthogonal, which is defined as E cross E y. You see, it is a unit vector because it's composed by unit vectors, which is orthogonal to the line of sight of the observer and the EY direction. This is crucial because what I want to do is to derive all the equation for the power and split it in two components that are related to these two directions. And that's useful because in this way I can study the polarization of the radiation. That we are going to see is going to be very relevant, okay? At this moment, we don't know. We still have to look at it. But it's this trick allows me to split the radiation into direction of the power that is emitted along a certain direction, the orthogonal direction, and if there is a difference between the two fluxes in the different directions, then it means that the radiation is polarized. So that's why I'm defining this vector. Then with this configuration, we can basically look what is the relation of, because you see I have all scalar products, so I need to work out all the relationship of these vectors with the angles. And E is going to be just the sinus of theta, zero cosinus of theta. So this is just polar coordinates. X is going to be equal to the sinus of phi, cosinus of phi, zero. Then we have beta, which is equal to the modulus of beta. And then the vector that identifies the direction of beta. And then we have the acceleration, beta phi dot minus sinus of phi minus cosinus of phi zero orthogonal. Okay, so these are just all the vectors that we need in our computations. You see, we have E beta, E and beta, and then we need the beta dot and the X. So all is expressed with respect to angles. So if I now continue with this equation one, that's going to be, so I'm just going to replace my vector here, 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 and here, okay, with these expressions. And we get beta, sorry. Beta cos phi cos theta E orthogonal plus sinus of phi E y. Okay. Then the other stuff that I'm going to do is basically approximate the angles because I have these cosinus and sinuses that are annoying, but we know that theta is of the order of gamma to the minus one. So they are very small, it's a very small number. Therefore, I can apply an expansion. Taylor expand cosinus, all the cosinuses and all the sinuses that are referring to theta. And for convenience, I express also the cosinus in terms of alpha, which is the vector that identify, oh, sorry, I mistook here. Then this should be alpha and theta is this one. Sorry, I mistook the angle here. So alpha, theta is this one and alpha is this one. Okay, good. So we go for the Taylor expansion. Now the cosinus and sinuses. And we have that the sinus of theta is equal to the sinus of pi half minus alpha. So just the alpha is just 2 pi minus theta, which is equal, I just use the properties of the cosinus of alpha, which at first, that in the Taylor expanded, if I Taylor expanded, I have that. Then we have the cosinus of theta. I do the same stuff. So I have the cosinus of pi I minus half equal to the sinus of alpha, that at first order is equal to alpha. Then we have the sinus of phi, which is equal to the sinus of omega Larmor t prime, right? Because phi is related to the angular orbit of our electron, and therefore it's related to the angular frequency. That's, now I go at an higher order. So I have the cosinus Larmor Larmor prime minus omega Larmor square t prime cubed. Sorry, they should be cubed because that's the higher order over six. Okay. And then we have the last angle that we need, which is cosinus of phi. Again, I just Taylor expanded minus omega square t, t prime over two. Okay. And now phi is small because I'm just looking at the instant in which the electron is kind of pointing in the forward direction, because that's the relevant one. Again, that's what this approximation here is basically for phi is done because of the beaming. Okay, we are only looking at the relevant emission. Having that, we find our expression for equation one, which give us that, well, let's write it, all of it, because that's the final result. We have that E cross beta is equal to beta alpha E orthogonal plus omega L T prime E Y. So now we have the explicit expression for these cross products that enters into here. Okay. Then we need to work out this other term. That enters into here. Then what we need to work out is this other term of our Taylor expansion. Let me add pages. Where is it? So we go for the term number two, which is this one. Okay. Hold on. The Fourier phase phi, which is defined as omega t prime minus ex over c. So you see, I'm just looking at this term here. Oh, damn it, it went down. Okay. Wait, sorry, I move the page. If I have to make the summary, it's going to be a bit of a mess. It's too late. Okay, anyway. So now what we do is just use our expression for E and X. So the definition of this vector, I gave them to you earlier, that are here. So this gives us an omega t prime minus x sinus of theta sinus of phi over c. Then I have my expression for the angles that I can explicitly give. I have the expression for x that is going to give us, and for x as a trick, I can use this fact that, and I can relate it to beta, because beta is just equal to that, but we know that beta is roughly equal to one. I can isolate x, c beta over omega l, and I plug it into here, okay? Then there are a little bit of tricks to be applied to this equation, but it's just algebra, which is completely boring and contains no physics whatsoever. That I'm going to skip here, but you find all steps that are indicated in a super explicit way in the notes. And you end up with that. Okay, where we can then extract 1 over gamma squared plus alpha. So extract it from the parentheses. And we have in the end omega t prime over 2, 1 over gamma squared plus alpha squared, 1 plus tau squared over 3, where now I define tau as this a dimensional time that it's related to the Larmor frequency. Okay. Furthermore, I can define as well a dimensional frequency. So that's a dimensional time. I can define a dimensional frequency, C, that is defined as omega over 3 omega L. You see that this relationship makes it dimensional. All the others are dimensionless quantities. And I get 3C tau over 2, 1 plus tau squared over 3. Okay, so here I'm just working out the Fourier phase for the tensors in the Fourier transforms here for the power spectrum. I'm just expressing explicitly the relationship of the vector with the angles using the approximation that we have. And I defined for convenience these two dimensionless quantity. And you will see why this is useful. Now that we have all of our relationships, we just have to plug our expression of E cross beta equal to beta alpha E orthogonal plus omega L T prime E Y that we derived before. And this relationship for psi in the power spectrum. Okay, here and here. If we do that, you see that I'm splitting the equation in two terms. So this guy here is going basically to be split into direction of the emitted power, orthogonal and in two directions that are orthogonal, that are pointing at the observer, but they are orthogonal one with respect to each other. And our spectrum, the E square over the omega. We have all the constants, E squared omega squared over 4 pi squared C. And then I have these two functions that now I'm going to give you the explicit expression, but I want to stress here the concept first. Okay, so you see all the constants are these guys here. And then we have this integral that is split into terms, one for the radiation orthogonal, I mean, in two terms that are orthogonal to the line of sight, to the line of sight to the observer. These functions are just related to this integral here. And we have the first one, g orthogonal omega, which is equal to the integral between minus infinite and infinite of beta alpha e to the I psi. And then I, of course, you see this is an integral with respect to the time. So here I just use the first component of our vector. You see this beta alpha is this guy. I have the exponential, which is this exponential here. And then I have the t that must be related to the tau, because the integral now is with respect to tau. So I make the derivative of this quantity to have the t prime that now I can plug in into our equation. They give us our integral with respect to tau. Okay. Now you see these are constants. I can bring them outside the integral. So I have beta alpha gamma minus 2 plus, alpha squared over omega L. And then I have what is dependent on the frequency, I phi the tau. And now you see why I introduced this dimensionless quantity, because all the quantities that are related to the system are outside the integral. This is an integral between minus infinite and infinite, which is related to Bessel functions. That guy here, this integral, is a special function that is called, this is a 1/3 of xi. Bessel function. Okay. I do the same for the other term here that is related to the other power, and I obtain something similar. I'm doing exactly the same again on the notes, on the lecture notes. You find the explicit derivation. Now I just give you the final result. Where again, you see there is another Bessel function. If I now put everything together into here, so I'm just plugging now back my result here and here, we find our final expression for the emitted power, for the power spectrum, where we have all our beloved constants, e squared omega squared over 3 pi squared c omega Larmor squared gamma minus 2 plus alpha squared over gamma minus 2 plus alpha squared. K to 1/3 xi plus k to 1/3 squared xi. And you see this is a frequency dependency. There is not only this omega squared, but there is also this frequency xi. You see there is an omega over omega L. So this is a function of omega over omega Larmor. Okay. That's our final result for the spectrum. Where you see the contribution of the two polarization modes. One is this one, that is the orthogonal component. And this was the one along the parallel component, which was related to the y direction, to the y axis. Okay. This one is the one that is going to rule, okay? Because for angles that are very small, this function is equal to zero. So for theta equal to zero, this guy here is equal to zero. Therefore, you see that we have a very strong polarization. Okay. Now just draw the spectrum so that you see how it looks like. So we have omega over omega Larmor. We have omega, so we have the power. So omega squared over omega. Should we introduce also the synchrotron? 2/3, but it's equal to something like that, where we have a typical cutoff here. You see where there is the Larmor frequency, one, then the exponential has a drop. So this term drops as omega to the omega over omega Larmor, sorry, omega c, minus one exponential of minus two omega over omega c. So we have a cutoff in the power spectrum. You see it's going down very sharply exponentially, and this is given by the Bessel function. Okay. So this Bessel function here contains this cutoff where we have this cutoff frequency that is in that function that is equal to 3 times omega Larmor gamma to the power of 2. Okay. Which if we expressed the Larmor formula, that's quite relevant. 3 e b gamma squared over mc. So you see that if one measures the spectrum of such a radiation and sees where the cutoff is, can measure the magnetic field. So it's a way to measure magnetic field in astrophysical objects. Okay, this other side, it's actually proportional to omega omega c 2/3. This is for the regime for which the frequency are way smaller with respect to the Larmor frequency. And you see it has a very mild growth, so it's kind of flat. So the spectrum is very extended. It's going to cover a very large regime of frequencies, typically in the radio wavelengths. And the fact that the spectrum is so large is due to the fact that we basically see for each individual electron, we see a small flash because we can only see the emission if the orbit is in the plane of the line of sight, because if the orbit is orthogonal or slightly inclined, because of beaming, the flux is going to be negligible. Therefore, we need the orbit to be pointing in our direction. So the electron is spinning in this way, okay? Because of beaming, we see the electron only when it's moving in our direction. So we see blink, blink, blink at extremely high frequencies. Okay. And this sharp blinking that we see from this electron give a very broad spectrum. So if you have in the time domain a very high frequency mode, in the power in the Fourier space, this mode is going to be very, very large. Okay. That's a property of the Fourier transforms. Okay, so this is given not by the Bessel function as the cutoff, but by the Larmor frequency and the fact that that we see the blinking because of beaming. Okay, that's the reason the power spectrum looks like this. Okay, we can have a break because I took